Hello, students of dynamics. This is Dr. Dan Baker, and today we're actually going to cover the last topic in our Newtonian kinetics chapter, which is going to deal with using our polar or r theta axis systems. Now, as we're adding in this last axis system in addition to tangent, normal, and also xy, we're actually going to revisit the topic of maybe using all three of the axis systems at once instead of each one independently. So let's go ahead and set up the basis for our applying Newtonian kinetics. Okay, anytime you see that word Newtonian kinetics, think, oh, that sum of the forces as a vector is equal to the mass times the acceleration as a vector. Basically, that is what Newtonian means. And the concept of kinetics, get this mouse out of the way over here, is just the fact that we're relating forces to motion, right? So not just motion by itself, but forces to motion. And so if we apply this equation for r and theta, we have sum of forces in the r equals mass times acceleration in the radial direction. And then sum of forces in the transverse or theta is equal to mass times acceleration in the theta. Now, you may not remember the exact equations, but you're probably like, oh yeah, and we had some equations for AR and A theta coming out of our particle motion chapter. That was that AR is equal to R double dot, which is the time rate of change of the rate that R is changing in length, right? It's basically the radial acceleration, how that arm R is either extending or contracting at a certain rate of a rate, right? That's what an acceleration is. And then r times theta dot squared, which is the rate of change of the direction of a theta, okay? Because remember that these acceleration terms are made up of both rates of change of lengths and also rates of change of direction. So a theta also has two components. One of these is r times theta double dot. And then the other one, we're going to add to that 2 times r dot theta dot. Once again, probably not an equation. You may decide to memorize it. You may not. It's on your equation sheet. But fundamentally, r and theta is really kind of the most complex coordinate system, because not only do we have complicated motion with accelerations, but also our velocities have both r and theta components. Okay. So same basic structure as we had for xy and also tangent normal. So like I said, this opens the door for having motion in all three coordinate systems. All right, so I'm going to draw a large diagram, and I would encourage you all to draw a large diagram as well, probably half the width of your paper, so you can comfortably fit all the different vectors we're going to add to this system. And I'll draw it kind of almost full screen size here. So here's my y-axis. Here is our x-axis. X and y-axes are a non-moving or a fixed axis system. And relative to those axes, let's say that we have a particle moving along a path, and that path looks something like this. And there's a particle that we're going to investigate, which currently lies right here on that path. Now, let me give you a little bit more information. One piece of information is that we can locate this particle with a r vector, a radial vector. So there is r. And that r vector, we have some information that it is currently instantaneously rotating in a direction positive with the right-hand rule. This is either omega or theta dot. Right, that's your angular velocity. Its sign comes from the right-hand rule, so this is positive from the right-hand rule. And then the last piece of information we have is related to the angular position, and our angular position will be located coming from horizontal up to that r vector, and we're going to call that theta. Okay, so that would be all the information we'd be given about the problem, and possibly some other information about what's the instantaneous r, maybe a function for r, what's going on. One thing we'll notice about this system, it is non-circular motion. The reason it's non-circular motion is that here's our origin point O, and essentially that the origin point is not the center of a circle. Okay, so if you have circular motion, your origin point is going to be the center of a circle, and that's not true in this case. We have some path defined by an equation, defined by some information. We'll get into the equations here as we go. So it's before we add anything else, let's add all of our axis systems to this drawing. Okay, so if we know that our angular velocity is positive from the right-hand rule, that means this arm R is going to swing kind of up and to the right. And so if it's swinging around point O in a positive right-hand rule, which is a counterclockwise direction, we also know that the velocity has to be going up to the right as well. The reason that we know that is that it has to basically work together with this angular velocity. The linear velocity and the angular velocity must agree. There's no way that I could have my omega positive and then my velocity coming back toward the origin. If this was a rigid arm, that's just impossible, right? The arm's swinging around counterclockwise, but the velocity of this end of it is coming back down this direction, it would just snap. Okay, so the directions of velocities have to be physically possible. Okay, so given this information about V, I can also add on here that this is my tangential axis direction. And I know that my normal axis direction is always perpendicular to my tangential, and it's going toward the center of curvature. Okay, so there's my T, there's my N. Conveniently, the X and Y, you just always bring them along. Okay, so our X and Y coordinate system do not change. So here's my X and here is my Y. X is still going to be horizontal, Y is going to be vertical. It doesn't mean you couldn't use a rotated coordinate system. Often we leave X and Y horizontal and vertical because we usually associate our weight force, which is one of the primary forces associated with the Y axis direction, being the negative Y direction. And then we're going to add our R and our theta. And so R is going to be coming out the radial arm, okay, so here is my R axis, and then theta is going in a direction of an increasing theta angle, so perpendicular to R, just like my R axis ended up splitting my X and T axes, my theta axis is going to come out here and split between my Y and my N, right? Because X is perpendicular to Y, T is perpendicular to N, and R is perpendicular to theta. So we could draw here that our theta axis is perpendicular there, so coming up in this direction here. All right, so there is are all my axis systems. Now, one thing to add onto here before we muddy the water by adding more and more terms, which there will be quite a few more we'll add, just note that we know that the theta angle is between horizontal up to R, okay? And horizontal is the x-axis. And so we could bring that theta angle up into here if we wanted to, between horizontal, which is the x-axis, to R. This is also the theta angle. Now it turns out once again, because R and theta are perpendicular and also X and Y are perpendicular, that if you could think that you could rotate, say, the X axis, a angle of theta, bringing it up to R, it also holds true that the angle between Y and theta is also theta degrees. Okay, or radians, just that theta angle. So you can do this all the way around if you wanted to, also in the positive axis directions. Okay, so that's bringing basically theta into the axis systems, determining that angle between the XY axis and your R theta axis system. All right, so bringing forces in. We're going to bring in a series of forces, and I'll list these one at a time. And so the first forces, and I will limit the number of forces that we included in this class to actually just four types of forces. There are others that we could add on, but it's already a complicated enough topic, so let's just keep it to four. So one of those forces is going to be a normal force, and this is going to be normal to the pushing arm. Because in most systems like this, what we're going to have is that this r axis isn't just going to be, or is r vector, isn't just going to be a vector, but it's going to be a physically rigid arm that's going to be pushing this particle along this predefined path. And so if this arm, which is defined by the r axis, is pushing on the particle, a normal force is going to be perpendicular to that arm. Okay, so normal to the pushing arm is going to be in the theta direction. Okay, so I could draw that on here. I'm going to call that force P. Okay, so this is force P, and it is located perpendicular to R along either the positive or negative theta axis. Okay, so that's force number one. I'll just use some bullets here. The second one that we'll take a look at is if there's friction along the path. Okay, so let's say that this path here might have some friction associated with that. And of course, we know that friction opposes motion. Okay, so if the motion of this particle, its velocity, is going up in the positive tangential, it turns out that our friction force is going to oppose that motion. Let's label that F sub F. So here's my friction force, F sub F, and it is going in the negative tangential. Okay, so that's two of our four. Getting on to the third one now, let's say that there is going to be a normal force from the path. So in the same way that your car tires provide you some friction, keeping you in the curve when you're driving in your car or your bike tires or whatever you're driving, your scooter, that we're going to have a normal force coming from the path, holding the particle in that path so it can curve around. Okay, I'm going to call this N. So here is my normal force, and in this case I've drawn in the positive normal direction. It turns out that the normal force could either be in the positive or the negative n, and it really just depends on the other forces acting on the system and what direction the particle is going in. And I'll talk more about that as we move forward here, but here is this n force, and it is in the positive or negative n direction, right? The positive or negative normal perpendicular to that path. So there's really two different normal forces fundamentally. There's a normal to the pushing arm and also a normal to the path. And I'm just labeling them P and N to give them some different labels. All right, so the last force that we could deal with, and that would be if this system was vertical. Okay, you're probably looking at this either flat on your desk or vertically on a screen, if it's on, say, your computer screen. And so if you held this up, if it is flat on a desk on your tablet, vertically, like a computer screen, we can think that this path and this arm and this particle are in a vertical plane, then we'd have to deal with the weight force. So this is the weight of the particle. And we know that weight forces always pull down toward the center of the Earth, and so this would be my weight force. Okay, so this is weight force W, and relative to our axis systems, this is in the negative y direction. Okay. Once again, there could be some other forces, but let's limit it to these for right now. All right, so one of the things you may have asked yourself, you may not have, but we found an angle theta that can help us find our angle between x and r, or between y and theta. But you may be asking, well, how do I use an angle, or what angle do I use between my r and my t? Right, basically between my polar axes and my tangent normal axes. So it turns out that we have an additional angle that is geometrically defined, not super hard to compute. Sorry, I didn't mean to change the colors there. Not super hard to compute, but it is always defined between the tangent and the positive or negative radial. And so I'll write that out here in a second, but we call it the angle psi. Looks kind of like a pitchfork. Okay, so this angle psi is between tangent and positive or negative r. So angle psi is defined as the angle between our tangent axis and positive or negative radial axis. And we have an equation for psi. Turns out that psi equals the inverse tangent, tan to the negative 1, of my instantaneous value of r divided by my instantaneous derivative of dr d theta. Okay, this is not the time rate of change of r. This is the theta rate of change of r. So this is our fundamental equation for theta. Because of the inverse tangent function, it turns out that psi has to always be between negative 90 and 90. So it can turn out to be negative. There's a bit of context in what makes it negative or not. It actually turns out that in this example above, we'd end up getting a negative psi value. And the reason I can tell that it's going to be negative is because when psi is negative, it's actually opposing our theta angle. Okay, so this theta is in a counterclockwise direction. This psi is in a clockwise direction. So this is negative from the right-hand rule. This is positive from the right-hand rule. And because they're opposing, it's negative. You don't really ever need to figure out positive and negative. I'll never ask you for that. It really becomes another angle in our system. And what we're going to do with this angle is that we need to resolve all of these four forces into a single coordinate system so that we can solve for unknowns. Okay, so we haven't talked about that piece yet, but we've basically created this free body diagram with all these different coordinate systems, and we need to resolve each of these forces into a single coordinate system. And it turns out that if a problem has r theta, tangent normal, and xy, we're going to push it to r theta. We're going to push it to the polar coordinate system because its motion is going to be defined by changes in this r and changes in this theta. Okay, so that pushes it into that r theta coordinate system. All right, so let me just write out a quick general process. And this actually would work on any problem with any coordinate system. So this would be a kinetics process. And I guess this process is kind of tailored toward these multi-axis systems because it will talk about those. But the first step is really to understand the motion, right? I'll say work because it does take some work sometimes to understand motion. Now that is not only how is this particle moving, why is it moving, what's pushing it along, what's slowing it down. Just get your head around the problem statement, get your head around the geometry, what exactly is happening. So one thing to get your head around, I talked a little bit earlier about non-circular motion. Okay, so this angle psi is only needed for non-circular motion. And fundamentally, because you need this dr d theta, you really are going to need an r equals a function of theta equation in order to use that psi equation. Okay, without r as a function of theta or information about dr d theta, I guess we could give you that like instantaneous snapshot, you can't compute psi. Okay, so there's kind of two clues there. Non-circular motion and also having an equation r varies as a function of theta. Once you understand your motion, you need to draw an accurate particle and axes. Okay, that's the first thing that I did up above on that example, is I spent the time to examine the motion and I drew my axis system with all of my positive assumed axes drawn. Now, if you draw your negative, just make sure you label them as negative or don't label them at all, however you want to handle that. Also, when I say accurate, rulers are a big help. Drawing large, using rulers probably will eliminate 80-90% of your confusion on these drawings. If you draw tiny with a bunch of squiggly lines and it's inaccurate, it'll be really hard to resolve the motion. Step three is that you want to add forces and our kinetic accelerations. Okay, so it actually turns out that I did not yet add my kinetic accelerations to this diagram. So let me scroll back up. And so once again, we're assuming this problem has information defined in the r and the theta. So let me label here, this would be my ar, right in the direction of my radial axes. And just not to draw over the top of p, let me go ahead and think about the line of action here of theta going out the theta axes. Now both r and theta could be positive, could be negative, so these are assumed positive, ar and a theta. So that would make this a combined free body diagram and in addition a kinetic diagram. All right. So coming back down to my list, onto step four, is to compute those acceleration components. And we're going to use the equations on the very top of this page, right? The AR and A theta equations, computing what is the numerical value for AR and A theta. And then step five, we're going to use our theta and psi angles to break forces into theta and R, so transverse and radial components. And solve our two equations. Sum of the force in the R equals mass times AR, and sum of the force in the theta equals mass times A theta. So there are the steps or the process for working through one of these motion problems. And again, the more forces that exist, the more effort that it is to resolve these angles. But I'll limit it to just those four possibilities, which is a normal force to the pushing arm. Okay, and that's basically normal to the R axis, which puts it in the positive or negative theta. If there's friction along the path, that will oppose the velocity or basically be in the negative tangential axis direction. A normal force from the path holds the particle in the curve. Now that can also technically be in the positive or negative normal axis direction, just depending on, honestly, it's the rate at which the particle's moving, right? The v squared over rho, if you're using a normal acceleration, also the radius, and then also what direction the weight is going in. Okay, so it's multiple things that are interacting there determining whether that normal force, which I usually assume is in the positive n direction. And if I'm wrong, I'll get a negative numeric value. And then find the weight. And the weight is really what we're looking at for horizontal or vertical. Another way that I'll typically indicate these, if weight is included, I would say this is the side view. If it's the top view, you know you're looking down, the weight's going to be down through the middle of the particle, and it will not be included in its overall motion. So you'll get to see how all of these different things interact and work as we do examples moving forward. Thanks for your attention today.